Hi. In this episode of Fatherhood 101, we're talking about becoming a patriarch by faithfulness to promises. God's purpose in human fatherhood is to represent His heavenly fatherhood on earth. We stand in God's place, representing His authority to the children God has given us. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, "We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making His appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God." If this is true of Christians more generally, how much more is it true of fathers toward their children? When one is sent on behalf of another, as fathers are sent to their children on behalf of God, it's a basic principle that the receiving parties will infer the character of the sender from the ambassador. In their hearts, children will internalize many basic characteristics of God from the character of their human father. If the father is harsh, legalistic, and arbitrary, then the children will conceptualize God the same way. If the father is absent or careless about sin, then the children will see God through that lens. No human father will be a perfect representation of God. But since salvation requires trust and surrender to Jesus, perhaps the most important characteristic of human fathers is that we be trustworthy. Children who cannot trust their fathers will have a more difficult time trusting God as Father, and the very invitation Christ makes for salvation will be less appealing to them. Trust is earned through faithfulness, and children recognize that he who is faithful in little is faithful in much. The notion that we fathers can fail to do the small things we've said, but come through when it really matters, is a fallacy and a self-deception. Coming through in small things builds confidence in our children's hearts that we will come through in the bigger things. We also often fail to realize that the things that seem small to us are huge in the eyes of our children. Another self-deception is that words we designate as promises are more important barometers of our faithfulness than simply things we said that we would do. Jesus said, "Let your yes be yes and your no be no. Anything beyond this comes from the evil one." Our children need to have no doubt that we'll come through on the things we've said and not have the nagging thought in their hearts, "I hope this isn't like the last time when Dad let me down." If we want them to trust God, we need to follow through on our own words. Our words to love and be faithful to their mother, our words to attend their events, provide for their needs, our words to be on time and provide a ride, our other provision that we've said we would. I haven't been a perfect husband or father, but my children have never wondered if I was cheating on their mother, or if I would provide the needed ride or the money or the provision when I said I would. Nor have they ever doubted if I would follow through on the promised spanking or other consequence for misbehavior. Parents who threaten spanking or other consequences, but who fail to follow through, create an image of God who's unprepared to follow through with the consequences of sin described in Scripture. Children internalize discipline as love, and it creates the comfort of boundaries. Sometimes it's not a matter of trying harder. In our own strength, we cannot even keep our word consistently due to our fallen, sinful nature. It's even harder if we have our own trust issues due to the failure of our own forefathers to keep their words to us and to our mothers. The natural inheritance we have from Adam leaves a legacy of failure and death. If there is seeming success, it's more in fields like athletics, business, music, education, and other worldly pursuits, rather than a demonstration of being trustworthy husbands and fathers. But in Christ, we can be redeemed from the empty way of life handed down by our forefathers. If we put to death our sinful nature through trust and surrender to Jesus, and if we are buried with Christ in baptism, we can rise up out of the waters of baptism to lead and live a new life. Those without the benefit of trustworthy human fathers can become patriarchs. The word patriarch is used in Scripture for men like Abraham and David, who originated something new in their family lines. The word literally means first father, from the Greek word patri, meaning father, and the Greek word arche, meaning first. Phil Robertson, the Duck Commander of Duck Dynasty fame, became the patriarch of the Robertson clan by trusting and surrendering to Jesus many years ago. And by choosing to keep his old man buried with Christ in baptism while working hard to build and establish a family that would honor Jesus by faith. My own father-in-law became a patriarch of his clan by saying yes to do something difficult for God and by leaving an old, ineffective religious wineskin, much like Abraham, who left his country, his people, and his father's household. I became a patriarch in my clan by being willing to leave the empty way of life handed down by my forefathers through trust and surrender to Jesus. And you can become a patriarch to your household through trust and surrender to Jesus if you are willing to leave the old ways, to die to them, to find something new in Christ Jesus. In Phil Robertson's life, he came under the discipleship of godly men who were able to set a trustworthy example for him and mold him into a man who could then set a trustworthy example for others. This is spiritual fatherhood, much like Elijah's fathering of Elisha in the book of 1 Kings and Paul's spiritual fatherhood of Timothy and of the Corinthians in the faith. In my own life, I came under the discipleship of my father-in-law and godly men he had trained. God provided these examples of godly fathers to help me overcome the untrustworthy example of my natural inheritance. If you have surrendered to Jesus, yet you still struggle with the basics of being a trustworthy husband and father, ask your Heavenly Father to send you a trustworthy example of human fatherhood to help you grow in trustworthiness. But remember that Scripture tells us to consider the outcome of their way of life before we imitate their faith. But discipleship is not a buffet where you can take the servings you like and ignore the rest. If a man of God is succeeding where you have failed, be wholehearted about imitating his faith. Don't be impressed by Bible knowledge or money or education or success by worldly standards. Don't be impressed by a religious position or a religious affiliation. If you want to become a man who is absolutely trustworthy in keeping his word, don't be fooled by smoke and mirrors. Learn from men who are absolutely trustworthy in keeping their own word. Pray for God to provide a spiritual father in Christ who can help you grow into a spiritual father in Christ. At the same time, realize that God's purpose in spiritual fatherhood, in making you a patriarch to your own household, goes beyond blessing your natural family. God wants your spiritual fatherhood to extend beyond your natural family to widows and orphans in their distress, and to fulfilling the Great Commission more globally. God will make you a patriarch so that you can call other men to be the first generation of godly fathers in their own households. You can't just tell them, you must show them. You can teach what you know, but you will impart who you are. Become the man you want your children and other fathers to be.
Written in the word, good, good word is a message from our God. Gonna tell you all about how to get to the kingdom, the good life. Word in the good, good word is a message from our God. Gonna tell you all about how to get to the kingdom, the good life. Oh, I love Jesus. La 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 la.